not 3:30, someone should raise their hand now. Okay. Hi, I'm Jennifer Gunn. I'm the director of the Institute for Advanced Study. Welcome to the last IAS Thursdays of the semester. We will be reconvening next semester on January 26th. And our speaker it's an environmental humanities talk. Our speaker is Eben Kirksey from the University of New South Wales, talking about multi-species families. And I think it will prove to be very interesting. I also just want to remind you that if there are any programs you missed this semester that you're dying to see, all but one of them are available on video. The videos are available on YouTube. You can find the link from the IAS website. I hope that everybody will have a great winter break and that maybe we'll have a return to the nice weather of November, but I'm not really expecting that. So today's talk is by Alison Griffiths, and it's co-sponsored by the Moving Image Media Studies group, the graduate program in the history of science, technology, and medicine, and the Department of Cultural Studies and Comparative Literature. And our speaker, Alison Griffiths, is a professor in the Department of Communication Studies at Baruch College and professor of theater in the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. She earned her PhD from New York University, and she's been the recipient of many grants, fellowships, and awards. Her publishing record is something to envy. She's the author of Difference, Cinema Anthropology, and Turn of the Century Visual Culture, which was published by Columbia University Press and won the Catherine S. Kovacs Award for the best published book in film and media studies. Her second book, Shivers Down Your Spine, Cinema Museums and the Immersive View, came out in 2008, and this current year, she has a new book out from Columbia University Press, Carceral Fantasies, Cinema in Prison in Early 20th Century America. Her interdisciplinary research, we love the interdisciplinary research here at the IAS, has appeared in journals such as Journal of Visual Culture, Cinema Journal, Screen, Film History, Wide Angle, Continuum, Visual Anthropology Review, Early Popular Visual Culture, and the Journal of Popular Film and Television, and she has numerous book chapters in anthologies elsewhere. So her talk today is titled Cinema on the Move, Museum-Sponsored Expedition Film from the Silent Film, from the Silent Era. So welcome, Alison.
This is part of the proverbial larger project, and as I've been informally telling people today, this is a very early articulation of this, what will eventually be a book-length project. I was serving as administrator last year, and when I came off of that term, thought it would be a mere easy dash into the archive to dig up everything on this film and write about it by, of course, early December, and it was not that at all. It was incredibly difficult and time-consuming, and so this is really a case of sort of getting something out, getting ideas out, and really sort of having the ideas emerge through the writing and through the telling. So I'm really thrilled that this is an incredible propitious moment for me to be here at this stage in the research to get some really great feedback, I hope, from you. So, without further ado, the interwar period was one of unprecedented global human mobility, undertaken by wealthy tourists, economic migrants and political refugees, and members of scientific expeditions. New circuits of travel created by the automobile and airline service altered the conventions of space and time, organized by railroads and steamships, opening up new areas of the world for explorers and well-heeled tourists. Writing in Popular Mechanics in 1932, Elmile Schumacher opined that, quote, "With the increasing use of such modern aids as the wireless, the airplane, the motorboat, and the automobile, the business of exploring the four corners of the globe and bringing back scientific data and specimens is rapidly being removed from the category of hazardous occupation, end quote. By the early 20s, expedition films were de rigueur in museums of natural history, seen as an important part of their institutional mission and accomplished either by equipping staff to shoot film or hiring professional cinematographers. Robert Flaherty's Nanook of the North in 1922 not only provoked Nanook mania among popular audiences, but spurred museums of natural history to visually document the expeditions they bankrolled, exploiting cinema's vocational propensity as a machine for knowing the world. If equipping expeditions with a filmmaking capacity became commonplace for large museums of science and natural history, there was less clarity on exactly what to do with the footage once it was shipped back to the institution. Beyond appropriating film within the model of the 19th century travelogue lecture, museums seldom screened films in the absence of a lecturer. The capacity to project film in the museum gallery had yet to be fully explored, and museums were often careless in documenting the content and production circumstances of the footage collected. So while museums of natural history seemed determined not to be left behind in an era of increasingly visualized mass media, institutional policies and practices were inconsistent and often informal. To illuminate this interwar period marked by significant improvised museum sponsorship of expedition filmmaking, this essay draws upon theories of travel writing as far back as the pre-modern Islamic period. I want to bring this novel perspective to examine a film shot as part of the, I'm now going to say AMNH, just speed it up a bit, sponsored 1926 Morden Clark Asiatic Expedition that followed the route of Marco Polo's Silk Road, an itinerary echoing that traversed by Middle Eastern travelers centuries earlier. The expedition was led by William J. Morden, the son of a railroad industrialist and honorary fellow and field associate in mammalogy at the AMNH, and James W. Clark, director of the New York Explorers Club in the 20s and head of the Department of Preparation at the AMNH. Morden was both expedition sponsor and leader. His field associate title was an honorific one, and like the figure of the traveler itself, he was something of a liminal figure at the museum, present as a funder, but not employed in any department and certainly not on payroll. Primarily zoological in focus, the expedition's mission was to collect samples of the Ovis poli sheep, purportedly discovered by Marco Polo and named after him, as well as specimens of the Tian Shan ibex, gazelles, and other mammals from the mountain plateau of Turkestan and Central Asia. Not wanting to be outdone by the Field Museum in Chicago that had boasted an impressive collection of Ovis poli hunted by Theodore Roosevelt, the AMNH wanted to install a habitat group of the sheep in their new Asian Hall of Mammals. After departing from New York in January 1926, Morden and Clark left Srinagar and Kashmir and headed toward the Russian Pamirs by way of the Gilgit-Hunza route. Traveling on foot, as well as by ponies, donkeys, yaks, and camels, amid difficult terrain and often snowy conditions, Morden Clark followed Polo's footsteps along the northern edge of the Taklamakan Desert, heading into the Tian Shan Mountains to shoot spiked ibex and roe deer, and eventually reaching Urumqi, the capital of Chinese Turkestan, in October 1926. I'm going to give you a little quick synopsis of the expedition here before we dive into something else. But after re-outfitting the party, the two men journeyed to Kechenjse, where they switched to camels for the final passage through Outer Mongolia. Morden and Clark had originally planned to join forces with the third Asiatic expedition, led by Dr. Roy Chapman Andrews of the AMNH in Hami, eastern Chinese Turkestan, but this plan was abandoned due to political instability in the region. After debating their options, Morden and Clark decided to head into Mongolia without proper paperwork, and roughly 6 weeks into the journey, the men were arrested and tortured as suspected spies by Mongol soldiers from a border patrol in the Altai Mountains. After several days in captivity, they were taken as prisoners to Kovdor, where Russian military officials vouched for their identity and rescued them. Morden and Clark were eventually granted permission to continue the 600-mile trek to Bilsk, where they caught a train to the Trans-Siberian Railway, taking them to Peking, and from there they left for New York. They'd been on the road for a year. Straddling two worlds of expeditionary travel in the early 20th century and boasting close professional ties to several elite organizations along with great personal wealth, Morden typifies expedition research funding at the time. He commissioned more than 14 films over his 34-year career. Clark shot the motion pictures, 18,000 feet of film edited into an 88-minute film. Sorry, 88 feet of footage edited into an 88-minute film. Took a significant number of the 4,000 photographs. Morden shot many of these as well. Helped hunt for Ovis Poli and documented the experience in popular press articles and a book called Good Hunting. Morden kept a four-volume fieldwork diary and published the monograph Across Asia, Snows and Deserts in 1927, and he too wrote dozens of articles in Natural History magazine. Excerpts from letters the men wrote to their wives were also published in Natural History magazine, designed to keep the readers up to date on the expedition's progress through monthly bulletins. So, my talk then, this is just the long preamble of what I'm going to be talking about, but my talk, as it now begins, really, places the writing and film generated by this expedition within a specific institutional and epistemological context, examining the literatures on early Islamic travel writing to sort of bring a new perspective to this under-theorized genre. The second part engages more directly with the film. I'll be showing some fairly lengthy clips, explicating its dominant visual tropes, and addressing the wider and persistent question of whether cinema can bridge the distance between travel as experience and travel as representation. The final part of the paper reconstructs how the film was used in lectures and private screenings in the homes of AM&E trustees in the late 1920s. This first part's called Morden Clark Expedition, Traversing a Distant Difficult Land. So by the mid-1920s, the AM&H was suffering from a severe fiscal crisis. In the financial and administrative report for 1926, AM&H President Henry Fairfield Osborne described the situation as very grave, a result of 120% rise in operating and administrative costs over the previous decade, with no corresponding increase in either the AM&H's endowment or city appropriations. In response, the museum cut $43,000 from its scientific and educational budget in 1926, which meant that, quote, the practical suspension of all the exploration and fieldwork except that provided by special gifts, unquote. Morden's ability to self-fund the expedition at a personal cost of $26,000. He paid for everything save for Clark's travel from New York to Bombay and from Beijing to New York could not have come at a more propitious moment, for here was much needed patronage. Sherkut M. Tarari's definition of patronage is, quote, the support, financial and political, encouragement, moral, social and economic, and championing of an individual or group engaged in an activity without which they would otherwise have difficulty performing that activity, end quote, accurately sums up Morden's relationship with the AM&H. His involvement with the museum extended back many years prior to 1926. In 1922, he funded the Morden African expedition that traveled to Kenya, Uganda, and Sudan. And the previous year, he led an expedition to the head of the Donship River in Yukon Territory in search of the white sheep from the area. For the African expedition, he hired professional cinematographer Herbert Tynes Cowling to shoot footage, evidence of cinema's established place among the arsenal of scientific recording techniques expected of a major expedition at the time. An avid hunter and traveler, Morden had his heart set on the 1926 expedition and was determined to recruit Clark, who had just taken up a position at the AM&H, to join him. Given his expertise in taxidermy and habitat group preparation, Clark, who kept his own taxidermy studio while also working at the AM&H, Clark would have been completely at ease in weaving art with zoology, recognizing that both were essential in the creation of illusionistic habitat groups, those scenic arrangements of animals and lifelike tableau vivant displays, that often included a heavy dose of highly conventionalized iconography, such as the nuclear family trope, designed to make the groups more relatable for human visitors. Not surprisingly, elements of fabrication infuse both travel writing and peripatetic cinema, with omission, misremembering, mispronunciation, temporal compression and expansion, and artistic license shaping media. According to travel theorist James E. Montgomery, travel literature celebrates the blurring of the distinctions which obtain between many of our most cherished heuristic and hermeneutic commonplaces: objectivity, subjectivity, real, imaginary, fact, fiction, textual tradition, empirical verification. The earliest travel records in existence, practical manuals from the 9th century onwards that gradually morphed into classic Arab geography, attest to this stylistic eclecticism, combining information about local marvels and phenomena with drier facts. In addition, elements of the wondrous crept in, stretching the reader's credulity to breaking point with tales of extraordinary animals or monsters. People always travel for a reason, including trade, religious and military conquest, escape from political violence and economic instability, spiritual pilgrimage, tourism, wanderlust, and the list goes on. A taxonomy of why, how, and who pays for travel can help organize the vast historical record of human mobility. Travel is, and always has been, expensive. Writing about the price of Islamic travel in the Middle Ages, Urari Tuati contrasts the exploits of the Egyptians, Iraqis, and Andalusians, who weren't averse to spending, quote, enormous amounts of money on their intellectual formation, end quote, while traveling the Islamic world, to travelers operating on far smaller budgets who put up with all manner of privations and deprivations. 9th century Abu Hatim al-Razi described how he and his traveling party walked for an entire day without eating and drinking, then a second and a third. By the evening of the third day, we were so exhausted that we collapsed on the ground. The next day, we continued on our route with difficulty. Despite employing a personal cook, servant, as well as English-speaking guides and interpreters in their 1926 Asian expedition, Morden and Clark likewise complained of exhaustion, assorted physical ailments, and the stress of not knowing how they would be greeted en route. Questions of subjectivity then loom large in the expressive and visual forms of the expedition film and travel writing. Different kinds of selves are recreated in the evidentiary and authoritative protocols of travel writing and travel cinema. The traveler has the power to put words to any situation, to anchor connotatively ambiguous meanings of what might be going on in the minds of those present. The mingling of geographical accuracy and the traveler's imagination characterize the genre of travel literature, and Clark and Morden fell back on such habits of seeing when they penned, well, habits of seeing and habits of writing, I'd say, when they penned accounts of their travels for popular audiences. They borrowed freely from different genres: journalism, boys' own adventure fiction, the diary, scientific reportage, adapting geographic, ethnographic, and technical language to suit their needs and audiences. They were undoubtedly familiar with the conventions of adventure filmmaking and moved in the same circles as famous taxidermist Carl Akeley, filmmaking couple Martin Rosa Johnson, and safari hunter Paul Rainey, whose 1912 film African Hunt was a huge hit. Morden and Clark's inability to speak any of the local languages of the people they encountered, not in the least bit unusual even today, makes for a potentially frustrating, at times comedic, cross-cultural encounter. Famous 14th century Islamic traveler and writer Ibn Battuta, who at age 20 traveled through Asia Minor and Turkey, tells an amusing tale about trying to be understood. We spoke to the man in Arabic, and he did not understand us. He spoke to us in Turkish, and we did not understand him. Then, he said, call the doctor of the law, for he knows Arabic. So the legist came and spoke to us in Persian. We addressed him in Arabic, but he did not understand us. Embarrassed by the fact that he had been caught out in a lie about knowing Arabic when he spoke Persian, the doctor of the law proffered the explanation that while he spoke the new Arabic, quote, these men speak the ancient Arabic speech. The situation ended happily for everyone involved, however, as Ibn Battuta was deemed especially honorable since he spoke the ancient language of the Prophet Muhammad. Many of the challenges Morden and Clark faced when they began their journey from the Karakorma Mountains in northern India to the Trans-Siberian Railroad stemmed from the fact that they were traversing a continent larger than the United States, a journey roughly the same distance as going from Corpus Christi, Texas, to Winnipeg, Canada, made up of mountains, deserts, plains, and valleys without any modern conveyances. In an article entitled How Modern Asia Travels, Morden pointed out that, quote, the armies of Genghis Khan, of Ogdai, and Kublai Khan, and Tamerlane were at least as well equipped, so so far as the transportation was concerned. They not only traveled 8,000 miles in the footsteps of Polo, but used modes of transportation virtually unchanged since the times of the earlier explorer, including wagons, carts, sleighs, horses. The horses went about 2,600 miles, yaks, donkeys, and camels, which went about 800 miles, which Clark described as, quote, truly wonderful beasts of burden, the railroad trains of Central Asia, end quote. Recounted Clark, and I quote, well could we have been with Marco Polo when he too journeyed through this land, for the centuries that have passed have brought not a single change to this remote and primitive setting of Central Asian hospitality, Clark. The historical resonance of famous travelers and warriors whose paths Morden and Clark followed was not lost on Clark, who described becoming, quote, philosophical as he gazed down at the land of Attila, Marco Polo, and Genghis Khan, unquote. Polo does triple duty in Clark's writings about the expedition, serving to geographically orient the reader, evoke the mythic quality of the expedition, and reinforce the idea of an unchanged landscape and people. Ironically, it may have been slightly easier for Marco Polo to travel in this region in 1271 with his father and uncle than it was for Morden and Clark, since much of Asia was under the rule of a unitary Mongol government in the 13th century, a fact that Polo scholar Mikita Jackson tells us, quote, greatly facilitated the opportunities for both merchants and missionaries to travel from Western Europe across the continent, opportunities which were not appreciably reduced by the empire's disintegration into a number of constituent states, end quote. So let me now segue into the closer discussion of the film. The section is called Textual Valences and Structural Absences. With no formal training in anthropology and little specialized knowledge of Central Asia, Morden embarked on the expedition spurred by his twin loves of hunting and adventure. His primary mission was to collect the heads and hides of Central Asian mammals, and this task involved prodigious logistical management, including the hiring of porters to carry supplies. The expedition began with 60 unskilled indigenous labor to carry no more than 60 pounds of equipment. This was mandated by the Indian government, although the number of porters hired fluctuated depending on the topography and their needs. Replenishing the labor force, since the men could only undertake 1 to 2 long marches at a time. Porters were requisitioned from local villages and paid a government set rate of 1 cent per mile. The plan also, as I said, was to meet up with Dr. Chapman Andrews in Central Asia and, of course, to get home in one piece. Clark used a Bell and Howell IMO camera, a compact 35 millimeter camera introduced in 1925, and photographic supplies bought from Eastman Kodak. The extant film opens with title cards and a close-up of Morden and Clark. There's Clark scratching their woolly hair and full beards. Images that really cast them, actually place them into the sort of central casting role of rugged travelers. Let's take a look at the opening of the film.
Thank you.
and just the kind of passion in this room reminds you of just how necessary the human voice is to really explain what is going on.
Icon next to the one that you just clicked on.
Oh, you know what it is? It looks totally different on my computer than it looks on the screen. The expedition spatial geography is presented via the map that combines the conventions of a live lecturer. A pointer is moved by hand to locate stages on the route with these animated pop-ups featuring keywords such as supplies. The shots of the porters carrying trunks on their shoulders through the ancient streets and stairs of the northern city of Srinagar, the Kashmir region, introduce this ubiquitous visual trope. Although a sense of the political economy is conveyed in the shot of the porters being hired. That's the shot you mentioned. The camera ultimately assumes the point of view of a dispassionate observer standing on the shore, a crew member seated directly behind an Indian man paddling, and a phantom ride perspective of the shore from the side of the barge. A quick succession of shots takes us deep into the mountains, over the Tragbal Pass, and to the rest house on the Burzal Pass. Morden and Clark have, so there's these shots, assembled a small army, and the scale of the human capital involved is remarkable. Clark later described the ascent, quote, "It was a hard, cold climb that took us several hours. Mounting the pass, we could see our promised land sweeping away to the west. A heavy snow had fallen over this area during the night, and the whole country looked like a freshly frosted cake. It was a foreboding land." With these opening shots of Morden Clark going native, merely hint at the actual physical discomfort each man experienced in the field, Morden's diary entries are more explicit, as when he describes the effect of snowburn on his face. "My face, which got very badly snowburned, has given me merry hell the last couple of days. It is all cracked and scabby now, though much of the swelling has gone from my cheeks. Yesterday and the day before, my eyes were nearly swollen shut in the morning. Had to ride all day, which was very tiring, as my right heel, blistered on the first day, has become an open sore. I have a pad around the sore to take off the pressure, but cannot walk much." It's interesting that the film spares the viewer from close-ups of Morden's swollen, scabby face, or feet. Although we do get to see their efforts to limit the effect of the sun damage, when they're shown in a two-shot wearing sun goggles with handkerchiefs over their forehead and noses. We also get to see local efforts to mitigate snowbird in a striking image of what looks like either human or animal hair wrapped across a man's face. Due to the remoteness of the terrain, Clark was limited in what was available to shoot, and three visual tropes emerged in his footage. The expedition party on the move that you just saw, the natural landscape, and ethnographic vignettes that caught his eyes, including the expedition campsite, indigenous dress, and faces of people along the way. These sequences organize visual material into a discourse, transforming the perception of travel into representation that is legible and, most importantly, usable. Sequences of marching not only denote the passage of time and monotony of travel, but also break up the film and make it easy to excerpt in lectures and in other contexts. So it's kind of modularized, right? As a habitat group preparer, Clark had considerable preparation for constructing photogenic sites through his viewfinder. So a lot of the landscape shots are there in order for him to kind of get visual perspective and data that he would then use in painting the backdrops of the groups. The 100 photographs constitute a remarkable record of the ecological landscape, an entanglement of the scientific with the prosaic. Perhaps inspired by by Robert Flaherty's famous sequence from Nanook of an igloo being built from scratch, Clark elected to shoot a shorter but equally fascinating sequence of a yurt being assembled and carried across the landscape by Kyrgyz people, a Turkish ethnic group from Kyrgyzstan. We'll see that in a little clip later on. Clark frequently films the expedition party marching toward the camera, past the camera, a classic trope dating from the early cinema period when cameramen often showcased cinema's kineticism by filming marches, parades, trains, and buses. He sometimes slightly elevates the camera, eliciting a series of return gazes. He also sometimes stations himself at the back of the group, gazing at the backs of animals disappearing into the distance. So you see there's the kind of return gaze of people coming towards the camera. The recurring image of a long snaking line of porters, that little dark line in the center, is basically the expedition party. That serves as a visual refrain in the film is discussed in one of Morden's natural history articles, when he admits that, quote, "One of the most vivid recollections of Himalayan travel is of a long file of gray-clad figures toiling upwards through the deep drifts of the Burzal Pass in the dim half-light of early dawn, with snow-clad peaks showing ghost-like against the gray sky." There's a cinematic quality to Morden's description of these marches, as if his memory of experiencing them and their incarnation of film had been collapsed. Recalling traveling by camel at night, required for animals to need cooler temperatures to work, Morden adds sensory information. Quote, "I can close my eyes and see the dim shapes of our 30 camels looking huge and weird against the background of snow that lay gray in the faint starlight. I can hear the camel bells clanging and moving in the darkness, their sounds punctuated now and then by the shouts of the caravan men, shouts that end eerily in high falsetto notes," end quote. The motion and sound had a somnambulistic effect on Morden, confessed to nodding off, noting that the camel drivers and porters, by draping themselves artfully over their donkeys, did in fact succumb to sleep. 18th century Andalusian Sufi poet Abu Hassan al-Shishtari captured in word what Morden experienced as he rode his camel under the cloak of darkness. "Desire drives the camels on the night journey when sleep calls out to their eyelids. Slacken the reins and let them lead, for they know the abode of the Nijad as well as anyone." The film gives little indication of temporality, and except for changes in the topography and the occasional appearance of the map, there's no way to gauge how far the expedition has traveled. More often, it's the change in animals that signals a new life of the journey. The significant change in tone around 14 minutes into the film, when the expedition party stops in a village in the Russian premieres, reminiscent of Native American cliff dwellers. And I'm going to just jump ahead and show you this little clip.
Thank you. Could they see any of the footage during that year?
No, they, so at this point, the footage that they'd shot to date got shipped back to Kashmir to go back to the United States. So they shipped it back in two big shipments, I think. So no, they weren't, as far as I've been able to find out. But that's a good question. Okay.
And it would have been on the process, right?
Correct. So, images of the human face feature prominently in this sequence. Clark wants us to meet these people as well as see examples of their social interactions, and maybe we see examples of their agriculture. The close-up of local people staring and smiling into the camera lightens the tone. And one shot in particular of an old man's wizened face and knowing stare reminds us of the long history of travel and cross-cultural encounters in the region, the kind of I've seen it all before look on that man's face. The Central Asiatic residents that Morden and Clark met were no strangers to foreigners, and though the two men may very well have been the first Americans to have traveled in the region for a while, they followed in a very long line of outsiders. Since Morden and Clark were not trained ethnologists and had no interest in deep ethnographic description, they were engaged in the ethnographic equivalent of small talk, defined as a discourse around uncontroversial or unimportant matters. Unable to speak the languages of the people they encountered, they relied on their translators to establish a relationship that would have made it possible to use their film camera. The idea of small talk opens up a textual space for examining the cultural interactions and negotiations occurring in front of the camera and at the edges of the frame in expedition filmmaking. And just as small talk gets the camera where it needs to be, what it records may also assume something of the same discursive features as small talk. The presence of furtive glances or staring that might precede small talk is conveyed in films many close-ups of indigenous men, women, and children. Shots that mobilize discourses of orientalism, self-love, and negotiations, and seeing the familiar in the unfamiliar. While people's rank, occupation, and gender in part determine the kind of activity they sometimes feel obliged to perform in front of the camera, there are some surprises. As in the sequence we just saw, which we're about to see, actually, in which formal shots of Russian soldiers saluting for the camera move into the cinematic equivalent of small talk as they begin to play instruments, dance, and the most risky of all, bathe naked in a hot spring protected by a yurt. I know, pretty tantalizing. I have to show you that now. I thought I had a clip of it here. Let me just get to it. Morden Clark got in, I think not at the same time as the Russians probably, but they did refer to enjoying the hot baths. If as narrative theorist Sheldon Liu claims, small talk as a mode of storytelling is, quote, a discourse of limits, its disengagement from official historical discourse is precisely what makes it useful in theorizing expedition cinema. Small talk's role in overcoming the fear and awkwardness of social interactions is legitimized in Clark's admission that he worried constantly about how he would be perceived and received throughout the journey. He refers to using a handbook with social, useful phrases as a social lubricant that he admits sometimes helped get him out of trouble. Morden seems increasingly obsessed in his fieldwork diary with hunting Ovis Polly's sheep as the expedition progresses. The two men were pleasantly surprised at the size of the Polly population, reporting that they saw 500 rams and 1,000 females over the course of the journey. He refers to using his telescope to scope back herds and becomes determined to find a ram with record-breaking horns. Although each time he thinks he succeeded, the measuring tape disappoints. Still, Morden was delighted with the excellent pictures Clark took of the sheep, the first of their kind for this particular breed, entering them into his motion picture logbook. The camera's proximity to the sheep in an edited sequence approximates the visual dynamics of the hunt, although we do not actually see shots being fired. The film cuts unexpectedly to a medium close-up of a dead Ovis Polly head, the tips of its huge curly horns extending beyond the edges of the frame. The gruesome reality of hunting Ovis Polly is censored, which conceals the extensive blood stains and gaping holes in the sheep's bodies that Morden writes about in his diary, in favor of the celebrated iconography of the safari shot, trophy shot. When Clark wounded a sheep with a smashed hind leg, he aimed again from 30 yards, quote, scoring a body shot that tore the lungs to pieces, end quote. Still alive, the ram ran another 100 yards before it finally collapsed. Despite being too damaged to mount in an exhibit, the animal was skinned. There's only one brief shot of a poly being skinned, with most of the action partly obscured by Morden in the foreground. Although, of course, this doesn't mean that there wasn't footage shot, it just didn't end up in the extant film. Violence, physical discomfort, and other unsavory aspects of the travel experience are elided in the film while giving voice in Morden's diary. Aware of the fact that members of the Explorers Club in New York would have been eager to see the heads of the Ovis Polly, Morden ensured there's ample footage of it, in one shot lifting up the Polly's head and moving it toward the camera, and in another raising the gazelle's head by its horns and rotating it. These macabre shots in which dead animals appear revivified may have been seen at the upper limits of what was appropriate for a general audience, but for Morden, they are long-awaited triumphal moments in a money shot. There's also a depiction of an animal being measured in preparation for taxidermy, a vital part of the process, according to Clark, since it was the skeleton that decided the species of an animal, not the skin. The largest poly head Morden measured was 57.5 inches, significantly shy of the record-holding 74 inches, although Morden was quick to point out that this head had not been honorably hunted, but was instead a pickup head, one that had been found. Once measured and separated from the bodies, the poly heads are shown tied onto the sides of the transport animals, a surreal image in which living beasts of burden are transformed into animal hearses. Other aspects of animal suffering are uncensored in the film, as when we see a pony getting stuck on a rocky incline, there are really detailed descriptions of how difficult it was for the animals. Just going to head to another clip here. Let me see what it is. I'll just read a little excerpt from Morden's diary here. It was so slippery and rough that no one dared ride his horse because of the deep crevices and huge potholes ever gaping up at one, ready to swallow one up if he should make a mistake. Our animals slipped and fell into deep surface pockets where they had to be completely unpacked and helped up to get a better footing. And many times we had to chop stairways for ourselves and our horses over these otherwise impassable sloping surfaces. Fortunately, none of the horses that they took with them were seriously injured or died, although Morden and Clark recalled this being a kind of an animal graveyard where they'd see the skeletons of animals with broken bones while he had fallen and been seriously hurt.
But these are known passes, I presume.
Well, if you can call them that, yes. And these ponies are remarkably capable of moving through this landscape. Actually, the yaks and the bullocks are even better equipped. But yeah, there's barely evidence of a pass here, but in theory, yes, it is a designated route. Okay, so. Relief came once the expedition entered the Turfan Depression, a landscape Clark compared to the Rockies. His description of the drifting of the smoke of the little fires and the pack horses contentedly feeding with the high snow-capped mountains showing through thick spruce is corroborated in the footage, a game paradise in which everything could relax, sit around a fire, get a haircut, and take a breather. Camped in the southwestern section of the 20,000-foot tall Tian Shan Mountains in Kazakhstan, Clark obtained footage of the nomadic Kazakhs. Although for fear that some of the expedition's horses might get stolen, the Yamban, a high district officer, sent a detachment of Chinese soldiers to protect the party. The footage is the most ethnographically rich of the film, since it was easier for Clark to be out and about with his lightweight and relatively inconspicuous IMO in the clement weather. Close-ups of faces, sheep shearing, wool and felt preparation, and flatbread making are just some of the local activities that he records. So even though Morden Clark had planned a dash through Mongolia, their starting point for caravan travel across the Gobi Desert, their capture and torture by Mongols forced them to take a more circuitous route to Peking. And Clark shoots some of the most amazing ethnographic footage in the final 15 or so minutes of the film. Now, unfortunately, the AMNH does not have a complete digital record of this entire film. And the last 15 minutes, I had to watch on a Betamax machine and hold my iPhone up to the screen to try and record it. But I see that there are stills from this film in the poster advertising my talk, so I need to talk to you further because it's such an incredible embarrassment that they have no, let alone restored print, that they weren't even able to give me a complete digitized print. So this is all I was able to get, was the 60 minutes and then the minutes. So I will spare you from looking at that because it's really awful, as I'm sure Maggie can attest from doing the same thing, watching early film, but this is really quite frustrating. But there are some incredible images in the last few minutes of the film. We return to the snowscape of the beginning. Morden Clark is shown wearing large fur hats. And there's this wonderful incongruous shot of Morden riding a tiny donkey while leading a long line of huge Bactrian camels across the plains that looks like it could be right out of the Buster Keaton film. And I think there's a kind of an uncanny symmetry in Clark's decision to once again focus on the camel's feet. There's a sequence early in the film where we see animals' feet. And it's also not hard to see a close resemblance to the end of Nanook of the North, where Flaherty filmed Nanook's pack of huskies huddled together in a fierce snowstorm, where the animals are turned into these snow sculptures. Okay, so back in New York, the Morden Clark expedition disseminated. Actually, I do have those of the camels. You can just see how pretty and awful that looks. So, I start with a quote. It must be the spirit of adventure coming down to us from roaming primitive man and still lingering in our blood that causes the word expedition to be so alluring, wrote Clark at the start of an article for Natural History magazine on expeditions. Admitting to seeing dream pictures in his mind of places he hoped one day to visit, Clark nevertheless insisted that the experience presented by expeditions was nothing like tourist travel. Quote, expeditions are not aimless pleasure jaunts, although they're often as such, but are instead carefully planned trips with definite purposes and objectives, end quote. On the road for a year, the Morden Clark Asiatic expedition was deemed a resounding success. And even though there's reference to the foolhardiness of Morden's decision to head north through Mongolia, from a PR point of view, the capture and torture of the Americans cast the museum in a favorable light, only adding to the excellent publicity around the expedition's accomplishments. One of the first public events linked to the expedition was Clark's appearance on the New York City radio station WEEF in early April 1927. Promoting Clark's upcoming broadcast appearance in the New York Times, they called the expedition one of the most dangerous and adventuresome trips in modern times, describing Morden and Clark as, quote, the only pure-blooded white man in the wilds of Central Asia at the time. Wow, imagine that. The two men's return to the U.S. took on the tenor of an international incident, and their kidnapping mobilized discourses of American grit, racial superiority, and imperialist expansion. The day after they returned to American soil, headlines including, as you can see, explorers back with marks of torture, blah, 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 dominated the national press, journalists having a field day with stereotypes of marauding Mongol peoples laying wait for unsuspecting Americans. In the parlance of 1920s adventure, the kidnapping transformed the expedition into, quote, their most thrilling adventure. And even though Morden Clark admitted poor judgment by failing to take the advice of their native guides who warned them not to go into Mongolia, the press glossed over this aspect, privileging instead the image of the heroic explorer. Morden even boasted that their capture, torture, and eventual release meant the story ranked high in the annals of adventure. And as Jason Marazzi reminds us in The Way of Herodotus, drama and tall stories are exactly what audiences expect in a lecture. Quote, when we're listening to a mountaineer discuss his latest expedition, we want frostbite and arguments in raging snowstorms. We'd like a broken leg, disaster on the summit, an avalanche in the descent, perhaps an abortive rescue mission, maybe even a death while we're at it. Above all, we want triumph and tragedy, for this is an intoxicating cocktail. There's nothing worse than the bloodlessly teetotal story that everything went to plan, the expedition was successful, and no one was hurt, end quote. There's little documentation concerning what happened to the expedition footage once it arrived in the US. An undated flyer for an illustrated Morden lecture with motion pictures and lantern slides was most likely part of the book tour, since it has the same name as Morden's book. Clark lectured with a film, evidenced by an inquiry made to the AMNH about recommendations for good lecturers in spring 27. Museum director George Sherwood wrote that Clark had just returned from Central Asia and had a fine series of pictures and speaks well, end quote. Clark was still giving talks on the expedition 5 years after we returned in 1942, the heart of Courant. Courant reported that he would deliver an illustrated lecture at the Horace Bushnell Memorial Hall that launched their new motion picture lecture series. The AMNH seemed as thrilled by the zoological specimens as they were by expedition photographs and the several thousand feet of motion pictures, giving them equal billing in the 1927 annual report. The president's report for that year was equally enthusiastic, noting that the expedition had returned not only with a fine series of skins, complete skeletons, and full scientific measurements, but a complete record of the trip in motion pictures, still photographs, and field notes. The film is treated in similar ways to the specimens, appearing at the end of an inventory of 7 types of mammals in the annual report, and in reference to the progress of the Asiatic haul that you see here. Given the amount of attention paid to the logistics of travel, the Morden Clark footage assumes a reflexive quality, a point not lost on an AMNH librarian who in the mid-80s wrote that the ethnographic content of the film was considerably outweighed by the attention to detail given the logistics of the expedition itself. The film undoubtedly provides information about the climate, habitation, animals, and people the expedition encountered, although it's difficult to match the footage to specific ethnic groups in the absence of program notes or a lecture or intertitles. Notwithstanding these deficiencies, the AMNH was enormously proud of the film. And in April 1927, President Osborne invited Mr. and Mrs. Morden and some of the younger trustees to a special dinner and screening at the Osborne's Fifth Avenue home. As expedition sponsor and director, Morden claimed ownership of the film and oversaw arrangements for developing it and editing it, telling Director Sherwood in a series of letters that negative should be turned over to a Mr. Holland and that 500-foot containers of positive cutouts would be delivered to a Miss Holland. That's all the information I have about who edited it and even where it ended up. Morden wanted to donate the film to the AMNH, but for tax purposes decided to deposit it in small batches, asking in return that he be allowed to have an Ovis Poli ram for his personal collection. So while the general public had ample access to the expedition photographs that were published in National Geographic, Natural History, the press, World's Work, the film never found an audience beyond the lecture circuit, Explorers Club, and AMNH events. Lacking intertitles and someone to champion its needs, its need to be more widely seen, the film was archived no differently from the zoological specimens it accompanied back from Central Asia. And while the AMNH established a committee in 1923 to support the preparation, use, and the preservation of motion pictures for scientific purposes, I've come across no subsequent mention of its activities. Regardless of the relative obscurity of the film beyond the circumscribed orbit of the AMH activities at the time, the footage offers some striking lessons for historians of nomadic cinema. While depicting the arresting landscape, wildlife, and human populations of Marco Polo's trade routes, the film also exposes the uncomfortable tensions of Morden Clark's own position as Western observers. Morden Clark's assumption that their white skin and American passports would guarantee them safe passage across a politically unstable Outer Mongolia suggests a misplaced confidence in their own position as filmmakers and travelers. And while Morden's cinematic images of the expedition conjure up a benign and open-minded global adventurer, his diaries frequently reveal his disgust at the native customs and peoples he encounters. Morden's small talk, cinematic and otherwise, may have served to lubricate the implicit social contract that permitted their passage and their filmmaking, but it failed to fully obscure the underlying relations of power and privilege fundamental to the encounter. So the expedition then, expedition film, is a beguiling example of what I call restless cinema, defined by contingency factors that are often legible from the shot itself, but frequently unknown. Of course, expeditions that are far more stationary, static than the Morden Clark long trek paradigm can allow the camera to settle down and become attuned to daily rhythms of life. Save for the opening phantom ride shots, the camera is often a static observer in the film, a factor undermining the very notion of restless cinema. The concept of restlessness is also undermined in the limited exhibition of expedition footage. This is stay-at-home cinema, not globe-trotting cinema. The camera equipment and exposed film is certainly precious cargo, though, made even more precious as time elapses, since we can most definitely experience an extraordinary journey that I think more than ever deserves to be seen by contemporary audiences in this film. So, at the same time as I'm exploring the idea of restless cinema, I'm also arguing against it. So maybe I will end with this wonderful paradox and invite your questions and comments. But thank you for listening.
I'll let you field your own questions.
Further on that, I must admit, tell me again what restless cinema means.
Well, I don't quite know yet. That's the thing. So what I'm trying to do here is sort of figure out what is unique about the expedition film, right? Because yes, it's related to ethnographic film, but ethnographic film was not always sponsored, did not always involve being on a journey, was not part of a larger it didn't necessarily have a larger purpose beyond just shooting footage. And I think it's also different to the travelogue. I mean, certainly there are some similarities, but expedition film, I think, because of that institutional patronage and because of its role within a larger kind of mission, I think deserves some kind of caution, and I think I'm hopefully going to try and sort of untangle what is unique about this mode of filmmaking and also the sort of context in which these films were made. So I'm thinking about this idea then of cinema that is not entirely, that's always on the move. So it's a peripatetic cinema. It's a cinema that's always being moved with the journey. But I want to play with the idea of restlessness in terms of it's not really quite sure necessarily what it should be looking at, who it should be looking at, for how long, and what's important. Right? And I think, I mean, we've all shot film on vacation, and there is this sense that you often don't know what to look at or what you should look at for any length of time. So I think restlessness may be, I mean, even though there are shots that are very slow, and in some ways this is a kind of slow cinema, I think that the idea of the uncertainty around restlessness, there's a kind of built-in, not feeling settled, right? And I think that the expedition film in some way, so it's a kind of a metaphor as well, perhaps, for the expedition film. It might very well be one of those kind of placeholder concepts that then gets tossed out. I love to tell this anecdote that when I was working on Wondrous Difference, I played with the idea of distinguishing between proto-ethnographic film and quasi-ethnographic film. And I was going to call my first two children proto and quasi, because I was so, that was it, I cracked. And proto were the real thing, so anthropologists making film out in the field, and quasi were ones that were made by not real anthropologists shooting film and showing them in commercial theaters. And then I realized, wait a minute, what happens when each is shown in either space? And so the whole taxonomy, the whole model paradigm fell apart, and I had to give up proto and quasi. So this might be, I don't know. This might not have legs, but we'll see.
Thank you.
Maggie, and then at the back.
Yeah, sort of on this topic, actually, and thanks. This is a really rich project. I'm excited to hear about it. I wanted to ask you not just about travel cinema or ethnographic film, but about your concept of cinema specifically and what cinema or the cinematic is doing. And I was really struck by the kind of comparison you made between the 13th century Sufi poet and Morden's own description of his ethnographic experience after the fact of filming, and how you mentioned the kind of sensory details in his oral description and how deeply impacted they were by his own experience of having filmed, you know, this travel. But it seems like you're also seeing a little bit of that in the 13th century poet's testimony. So to what extent is cinematic restlessness or cinematic travel even contingent upon the use of cinematic technologies, and to what extent does it sort of emerge from a particular experience of travel writing and ethnographic mobility?
Right, and I think that's a very dense, wonderful question. I'm very interested in the idea of cinema's kind of sensory modalities or kind of sensory possibilities. And I think in some ways that's the tension that we see, right? I mean, we see these images that are so poetic that yes, there's a kind of surfeit of information, but there's a kind of sense, there's a kind of surfeit of feeling. And I think that what I'm trying to do is work with this triangulated series of texts, right, of data. So there are the diaries, the published accounts, and then there's the film. And I think that in many ways, you know, the senses kind of surface in them, but then they're also suppressed. So there's a very strong sense of genre, of audience, of masculinity. I mean, everything's kind of thrown in there. So what I was interested in doing with the medieval Islamic writers is, I mean, I was really struck by some of the correspondences across their modes of writing, right? This similar kind of elliptical quality, this similar idea of really not knowing what to focus on, right? That there's the fantastical, and then there's the monstrous, and then this obsession with numbers and measuring. There's, you know, formally it's kind of all over the place. And I think in some ways, this is what you see in some expedition footage, that there's an uncertainty about what are we meant to be doing in this film, other than just getting the camera out now and again, showing there's the sheep, check, got that, faces of people. And, you know, can you be trained to learn how to shoot expedition footage? I mean, obviously someone with a background in documentary. So, and I'm at the very early stage of just getting through this reading and thinking about how this idea of almost kind of nostalgia for something that hasn't happened, right? So maybe working as well with the idea of nostalgia. In other words, this anticipation of something that you'll see, and how you then maybe use cinema, and is cinema better equipped than travel writing? Or is travel writing better in some ways at enunciating things than cinema? And so, I mean, one could argue you need both, but, you know, different kinds of voices, different kinds of, different kinds of subjectivity emerge and are constructed in each. So that's just a partial response, but I think, yeah, that's certainly where I'm wanting to head with this in terms of more research. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, jumping ahead, sorry.
So I have a series of short questions. So one of the, I thought, what's the distinction between the footage and the film? Since they shoot the footage, but they don't make the film, as I understood it from you. So that's one question. What did they think of the film? Once it was made, did they have a script that they used when they did their performances or their whatever you would call them? And can you treat two questions? Can you treat the film without their narration, since they in a sense gave voice to it? And then finally, did they ever show it to music?
Okay. All right. Great. So. Right, so I refer to footage in the sort of expansive sense that there must have been more that they shot, right? That obviously didn't end up in the film. So the film is this extant 88 minutes. I refer to footage because I imagine that what was shot at that particular time was perhaps only a fragment. So I'm kind of evoking the larger body of film that I'm assuming has been lost. I haven't actually done the calculations. This is actually prompting me to do that. So 18,000 feet of film, 5 reels of film. So how much leftover film do we have in that calculation? In other words, can we calculate roughly how much was left? I mean, how much ended up on the editing floor? So yes, in many ways, there is no distinction. I mean, I could use the word film, but kind of felt important for me to kind of at least suggest this idea that this was a part of something bigger, but I might be corrected there. What did they think of it? Besides words like excellent motion pictures, fine footage, used the telescope, got out the IMO, absolutely no idea. There are no references other than just the act of taking and some very, very, ordinary adjectives to describe what they shot. I found nothing in a tremendous amount of archival material I have plowed through.
So when they watched it, they didn't register?
Nothing at all. They, I'm sure, had a script. It appears that each of them traveled with the film, lectured with the film, so somebody must have written a script, nothing. And I've gone through I bore you with archive macho, but trust me, a lot of boxes and nothing. So what is our experience of it now, in the absence of them being there to lecture around it? Well, it's clearly a very different kind of experience, right? The film clearly could be re-signified depending on whether it's to the guys at the Explorers Club, whether it's in Hartford, Connecticut, whether it's being used in a museum lecture, or whether it ever, or how it was used in the trustee, with the fellow trustees. What we do know is that the film was used to inspire other trustees to give money to fund more expeditions, because at this point in time, this was the only way to get these expeditions out, because they were really hurting, and it just got worse as the stock market crashed and it went into the 30s. I talked a little bit about this in another essay that I've written. In some ways, it is a film at the same time as it kind of undermines the notions of what we mean by a film, in terms of its protocols of exhibition, and how it conforms to so much of what we think a film should do in the mid-20s, it doesn't do that. It's kind of undermining itself in that respect.
So thanks, this is fantastic. I have some comments on a question that I've been thinking about this in dialogue with some similar films from Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. Some of them from these great numbers from later, the post-war period. The first has to do with tropes in the films, and I mean, Stephen speaks of it, so Maggie's got them as well, right? There are tropes in these films as a genre, the exhibition films
right.
A genre, that have to do with a colonial gaze, right, with the sort of thin line that you've been describing between ethnography and adventure. Right. But there's also the trope of the film as a kind of a media event, right, that you've described so well. And I think it's really fascinating to see that this works in the US case as well, like somebody working from a different context. So that there are these diaries and the books and the journal writing, you know, and there's this whole, right, again, media event surrounding it, much of which it seems to be about, as you described, fetishization of the camera too, or fetishization of the process of making it. Right, of all the preparation that go into the expedition, there's so much gear, there's so much technology, which seems to speak in a certain way to some aspects of cinematic specificity. But a question about this then is, does the museum benefit also from the kind of celebrity status, right, that explorers have? And if so, how? And then a related comment to this, especially seeing the Red Army soldiers in the film, it's really striking to think about Zika Vertov's When Sixth of the World is not too much later than this, I think, going through similar territories. And Emma Wittes' book, Visions of a New Land, looks at Soviet expedition films in the 30s, which might be interesting to look at.
Yes.
In dialogue with this. The sponsorship is probably somewhat different, but it might be an interesting analogy.
Right. I think. Absolutely, they leveraged as much as they could from the celebrity status. What was interesting going through all these internal documents at the same time, they're trying to secure multiple prints of Nanook, they're trying to work with the Johnsons. But at the same time, there is this concern about, the safari genre or the adventure genre, potentially just slightly contaminating. I mean, it's this classic trope of the kind of popular creeping in here. They were reluctant to let Clark go, and I think that to basically embark on the expedition with Morden. And I think that, and to me, it's kind of ironic because I mean, they just hired him, and they really needed him to install all the exhibits for the Asiatic Hall. And so he clearly was not as much of a, I mean, Morden isn't a household name either. So these, within the kind of elite New York adventurer kind of fundraising milieu, these were household names. Neither of them, I mean, Morden definitely falls into the kind of globe-trotting, someone who kind of was influential, not just within the US, but I mean, I think had lectured in London a little bit. Don't think he took the film. But it kind of depends what you mean by celebrity. I mean, I think it's a very kind of small celebrity here. And I'm thinking about the planetarium guy who's become, of course, the biggest name.
Neil deGrasse Tyson,
right? I mean, certainly they got close to that. And Morden had quite a few sort of personal issues, which I sort of haven't put into the paper, but I've come across. Which I think explains, some of the tone of the diaries and some of the issues that he's grappling with as a historian too. It's tricky to know how to handle some of the very personal stuff that's in there. So and then I'm very interested in. I haven't seen these Russian films, but I think it would be really interesting in terms of tropes. Obviously. There are prisoner of war films, which are again about moving people through space with equipment, and I've seen some of those from the late, from World War I. There is this kind of issue of what are the limits of knowledge that one can gain when you are traveling, but also when you're constrained by equipment and by logistics and also by climate. And so, that's why I think that it's really important that these other texts exist, because I can't imagine just really trying to work with this film without being able to triangulate. Because I think that does compensate a little bit. I'm able to access a little bit of the subjectivity through the articles, although there's an incredible amount of repetition across these natural history articles. And also, the mainstream magazines at the time wanted access to the photos as well. And what's been interesting is the idea of the kind of scoop. So who were they going to give the photographs to first? Because the Times didn't want them for World War Cat, though. So the idea that you can only really exploit these images so much. And you saw in the Yak Mobile caption, obviously, you know, you can kind of get a sense of who these images are, you know, designed to be seen by. I mean, how they've been captured, how the meanings have been anchored.
Thanks again for this wonderful talk. And there's a lot more that I'd like to ask you, but for now, I'm just curious about the treatment of landscape in the imagery in the film. It seemed to me there was a tension between landscape as this kind of backdrop, which you mentioned that Clark was painting these, you know, eventually as sort of dioramic backdrops. So there's these sort of grand, almost flattened landscapes. And then there was this idea of landscape or even nature itself as sort of an active participant in the journey, and that was really illustrated so beautifully in that scene where the donkey or the little ponies were falling down the rocks. So I'm wondering about the Morden and Clark's sort of attitudes toward landscape and maybe sort of the concept of nature, and if this maybe reflects something or if it's in dialogue with sort of larger American attitudes to landscape at the time. And I'm wondering if this is an avenue you might be taking or if you've thought about this at all.
Well, it's their kind of arch nemesis most of the time, right? I mean, it's the thing that they have to battle and to conquer. And yet they can adapt. And so there's a great shot early on of them wearing these grass shoes. Which are kind of snowshoes, and you wear wool underneath, and so there's a sense that they are willing to adapt to the landscape, and yet they brought their servants and cooks, etc., with them. That tension in terms of sort of images of the landscape, I think, is really interesting in terms of how we become invested how we kind of get stitched in. As viewers, because I think that in terms of our empathy and our ability to kind of feel the sort of drama of the moment, and obviously from a very 21st century point of view, the kind of, you know, ordeal that these animals are being faced with. But I do think that we in terms of the sort of sensory thing, I think that we're emotionally sort of pulled in and entangled in the landscape in very different ways. There are times when, you know, quite a long take of people just plodding through the landscape, kind of. I mean, I think our spectatorship can be quite sort of embodied, and I think that, you know, there's a lot more than meets the eye, I think, in terms of this just being, well, it's just footage of them on the road. I think that there are very interesting kind of modalities, depending on where the camera is, depending on the kind of point of view that we've been given. There's incredible respect. Despite logistics, they are very nostalgic. There's that classic traveler trope of, well, this reminds me of, right? I mean, so there's always this evocation of this great American landscape, and so they talk about the Rockies, this reminds them of that. They are suffering, but they seem to be incredibly, very present in terms of appreciating what it is they're surrounded by. The idea of nature is this. I mean, it's, as I said, it's given a huge amount of agency, and so storms and things like that are somewhat anthropomorphized, and there's quite a lot of compassion for animals too. I mean, Morden was eager to write that animals weren't hurt, and there is a kind of sensitivity, and the little shot with the dogs as well was, I thought, quite touching. But I do like the idea of, you know, sort of pulling in sort of theories of the picturesque and the kind of idyllic, especially at this time when there are concerns about inevitable change. And I think it would be interesting to kind of pull in some of the theory around the habitat groups too, in terms of perspective and in terms of the kind of sublime. People I think are aware of the fact that these are based on actual vistas, but I think that it would be interesting to maybe try and look at how these landscapes that ended up getting recreated in the backdrops to the exhibits, which I haven't had a chance to do yet. I mean, that might be an interesting kind of other angle, and to kind of see how the animals show as well.
Was someone behind me?
No, sir.
I was going to ask you about taxidermy, just because it's the upper Midwest. past, and you mentioned it, so really, not let that lie.
Yeah.
But have you thought about the relationship between film and the processing, sending it back, as well as the kind of deconstructed animal that is then reconstructed in New York? Like you mentioned, Mr. and Mrs. Holland are the ones who process and edit the film. But is any discussion made of who puts together the sheet for the dioramas? Especially because at the end, doesn't he mentioned that he exchanges or asks to exchange the film for a sheet?
Yeah, well, yes, absolutely. Absolutely. That's the fundamental.
Pete Graham's question.
Yes, I will. So the question is about taxidermy as a kind of metaphor for cinema, right? In terms of the film, both the film and the mammals are back and are then have to be reconstructed into living things. Yeah, it's a really fun way of conceptualizing that, right? I mean, I have it down as a kind of list of, well, they're treated similarly, but I love the metaphoric kind of richness of what you're
and
suggesting.
And even thinking of the weight of transporting them back to Srinagar, and then I would imagine by a boat back
yes.
to New York.
Right, so they had about 100 skeletons and heads and pelts that they transported back. And we do have information of telegrams indicating when all this stuff arrives back at the museum. And we do know a lot more about the animal taxidermy preparation than we do about the film. And you know, I mean, I've written about, and Don Haraway has too, about sort of taxidermy as the cinematic, right? I mean, ontologically, phenomenologically, I mean, metaphorically, there's all this interesting consonances. But I think that what can we say beyond the kind of basic metaphor? You know, there's clearly an enduring dimension to the taxidermy specimens, right? I mean, they're wondrous. They are the highlights of anyone's visit to the museum, and they have endured. Despite the fact that I discovered as early as the 1920s, they were complaining that midges were destroying the pelts, and so they're figuring out the right solution to keep on spraying them. So, you know, these exhibits do degrade, just like cinema does. So there's another. In fact, at the British Museum, they've decided not to replace their taxidermy specimens as they get really mangy and so on. They have little signs saying, okay, he looks like he needs an upgrade, but, you know, Tommy the Tiger is just going to deteriorate, because they're, which is sort of interesting. So, you know, in terms of legacy, then, right? I mean, this film, in terms of that capturing of the experience turned into representation. Taxidermy is obviously, you know, fares better than cinema in some instances. And I think that, I think the Museum of Natural History, not to go too much off topic, has always had a problem with what to do with film. I mean, it still doesn't know what to do with film, really, right? And it has the Mead Festival, which it now doesn't ever put in its auditorium because heaven forbid they'd lose their IMAX revenue for 2 days, right? So all the films are in locations around the main IMAX screening. You know, they've had series over time. I had only recently remembered, because it hadn't come on my radar, that they had a Silk Road exhibit there, I think, 3 years ago. So I'm immediately going to go back and see how they kind of told that story, right? And used their artifacts, etc. But I think ultimately they realize that, you know, it's the kind of aura of the wondrous specimen that's much more captivating than a 2D film. So, any final thoughts or comments?
Well, if not, let us thank Alison.